SORRAT stands for the Society for Research on Rapport and Telekinesis. And this is a group that was started in 1961 by the poet John G. Neihardt. He's known as the Poet Laureate of the Plains States. And he's also the author of the book Black Elk Speaks. And he was a very famous poet, and he was a college professor at the University of Missouri in Columbia at the end of his life. And he gathered together a group of college students because he was interested in spiritualism. And so they met every Friday beginning in 1961. And after about 3 months or so, they started getting unusual phenomena like rapping sounds coming out of the floor. And they devised a system for communicating with these raps. And it turned out to be the spiritual entity Black Elk, who Neihardt knew very well. So he put a lot of effort into testing the phenomenon. They even disassembled chairs where the raps came, and he had everyone put their feet on pillows, and he had people bring in someone brought in a sniper scope to see whether anyone was producing this effect in the darkness. And eventually he satisfied himself that this was actually some kind of paranormal force. We as sociologists of religion need to realize that all great religions began within the context of small groups. People meeting in small groups and having within many religious movements, these small groups had miraculous experiences. For example, Christianity. A small group of men were meeting together regularly. One of their members was a magical performer. He could do healings. He could do miraculous events. And this is documented by the gospel writers. And although those stories may have been embellished, it seems highly probable that there's kind of a core element within those stories which, you know, stimulated people to believe. The original apostles, why were they motivated to follow this guy? More than likely, he attracted them to him because of his ability as a performer of miracles. And the Gospels are very clear that in the early church history, the apostles performed miracles, and that's why people were attracted to them. And when we look at the spread of Christianity through Europe, these early missionaries did miraculous healings, and they did performances. So if we want to understand how religions, the great religions, spread, we need to understand miraculous performance, because that's an element within religion. So that's what's happening within SORRAT. Now, it's shaped and bent by the scientific context of our era. So instead of just performing out in the open and attracting crowds, instead we see scientists coming and trying to establish the paranormal quality of the phenomena. And just like as Jesus encountered, people are highly skeptical, and he's not universally accepted. I first met Ed Cox in 1980, and he showed me some Xeroxes of objects moving. They're Xeroxes of film segments of things happening in his mini lab. And he showed me a Xerox of a pen which lifted up, theoretically, supernaturally, and it wrote, "Rethink time." And I thought, that's kind of strange. This is a little bit too bizarre for anyone to accept the idea a pen would just lift up paranormally and write, "Rethink time." So he gave me this Xerox, I took it home, and I kind of thought about it. And then when I met him the next year at another conference, he made this presentation before the parapsychologists, and they laughed at him. And I thought, well, as an expert in deviant behavior, this is exactly the kind of thing I'm interested in, and I'm interested in deviant scientists, and he seemed to fall in that category. So I went out to Rolla, Missouri to just to kind of see what was going on, and planning to catch the tricksters. But when I went out there, instead of finding any kind of main line scientific endeavor going on, it was actually a kind of small group phenomena. I sat in a Dr. J. T. Richards' living room, John Thomas Richards' living room, and the raps started coming out of the floor, and you could talk with them, and they would spell out messages. And I had talked with magicians before about the ways of duplicating this kind of phenomena, and it was very disconcerting because it was pretty clear that the raps weren't following any kind of normal pattern in the way a magician would do this kind of thing. Since that original investigation in 1981, other people who are pretty knowledgeable in magic have gone out there, and people really can't explain why these effects act the way they do, why the rapping sounds are the way they are, except that I notice as a social scientist, this is the same kind of phenomena that anthropologists have observed among American Indian tribes, where they go into tent, they go into their teepee, and they close the flaps, and the teepee sides would shake, and the spirits would spell out messages. And same kind of phenomena that we've noticed a lot of shamanic performances involve this kind of psychokinetic phenomena. So I think that we might reevaluate some of our analysis and recognize that there's something deeply anomalous about some of these things. So in 1981, I traveled out to Rolla, Missouri, and I began interviewing these people and engaging in participant observation. And Cox was took his experimentation even farther. He took his mini lab to a locksmith and had the locksmith seal it up. And they broke off a key inside the locks and poured epoxy glue in, and they sealed up all the box was very, very well sealed. And yet phenomena still came out. A number of quarters came out through the front of the glass front of the mini lab, and they captured that on film. So the effects seemed to be very strong. Then in 1983, I decided I'd start doing videotaping myself. I'd videotape my interviews. And
I've seen so much of the levitation and so much of this other things happen. I don't think of it being astonishing. I think what's astonishing about it is how much closer you can get closer, what I call God. And but to say any one time was been an astonishing experience, I feel when a person gets close to God or they feel oneness with the all, is really one of the just a real great feeling, and it kind of renews my faith. It also recharges my batteries.
I videotaped some of the rapping sounds, or you know, people listening to the rapping sounds, and I videotaped some of the table tipping phenomena where the table seemed to jump around. And I videotaped Cox and his mini lab, which seemingly was sealed up pretty tight, and he demonstrated how it was still sealed. And then while I was there, objects came into the mini lab, a leather ring and a quarter and a glass bottle. And the point I'm trying to make isn't to establish the authenticity of this phenomenon. That's beyond the scope of social scientific research. But the point that I'm trying to make is that these kinds of effects, these, in a way, it's like they're miraculous phenomena. This seems to have an effect on people's belief systems. So sociologists of religion are interested in why people join these small groups. Why do people join cults? And they've devised a number of theories which explain that. One theory is the deprivation ideological appeal theory that hypothesizes that a group's ideology attracts certain people because it meets their needs or deprivations. And another orientation argues that social networks are very important in cult recruitment. And another orientation notes that people need to be structurally available. They need to be free from other ideological commitments before they join. And my research seems to indicate that all these processes are occurring within this group and within this group's recruitment. But the central element is wondrous experiences or anomalous experiences that people who participate in this have these perceptions that something miraculous is occurring, and that's what holds their interest. That's what attracts them. And it seems to me from my reading of religious history that these same things have been going on in all the major religions. Some people experience miraculous events, and that captures their interest, and that holds their interest in the religion. And if we look at the history of, say, Christianity, Jesus attracted the multitudes through performing miracles. And his disciples did the same thing after his death. And if we look at the history of Buddhism, the same thing happened through China and Japan. Buddhist missionaries performed miraculous events. So I would argue that if we want to understand how these religions were successful, we need to look at small groups and these miraculous performances that occur within these small groups.